Yeah, what kind of background do we have, actually, speaking of backgrounds? Anyone here actually computational in nature? Awesome. Any medical folks? Who's medical? Wave people. Okay, good. What are the other people, if you're not?
So we have business, arts, business. Science. I think those are the general
good
backgrounds.
Any creative nonfiction? Anybody there? Yeah. Good. Good. Poets? Any poets? Yeah. Good. Yeah, okay. So. Good. How's the sound? Is it? We're okay.
But you told me that your poetry career and your professional career are still kept entirely separate, right?
You can't keep anything entirely separate.
See,
even if you try,
it's still all you, eh?
They inform the other. You can't do one without the other. It'd be too much work to tease them apart, I think.
Right. Okay. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I it's after 2 o'clock, so. There are lots of things. I could give a very lengthy introduction to Patrick Pilarski, but the problem with that is that would take time away from what he has to tell you, which I think will be much more interesting. So he has his own TED Talk. We've sent you a PDF of a little teaser of what he does and what he's going to talk about today. And so I would say, take it away, and we're looking forward to this very much.
Great. Thanks so much, Kim. So I will follow in Kim's lead and not actually do much of an introduction. I'm Patrick Pilarski, and I'm with the RLAI Lab, Reinforcement Learning and Artificial Intelligence Lab, and also the Alberta Innovate Center for Machine Learning. And so my job today is going to be to, hopefully, if I do my job well, to give you some background, to let you understand some of the fundamentals of machine intelligence and be able to sort of take those and think about how that might apply to other things in medicine and also in society at large. So in particular, I'm going to go through a few specific learning objectives. One, I'm hoping by the end of this you'll be able to both clearly define and discuss machine intelligence. You might not give a definition everyone agrees with, but you'll be able to define it. You should be able to state why machine intelligence is actually important, maybe to you, but to society at large. As we step further on, we're going to look more into what machine intelligence actually does, how it goes about doing its business. And this means thinking about what machines might learn, how they might go about learning those things, and also understand when machines might learn. And we're going to explore all these issues. Did everyone get the cheat sheet I sent out, the one-page, very short article? Okay, so if you ignore me all class, at least you can look back at that and you should get the gist of almost everything. But first of all, I'm going to motivate this with a waterfall. Or more particularly, I hope you can all see, but there's a dark field there with a little skinny waterfall. And so the important thing here is to think that not too long ago, only a thin, tiny trickle of water, or trickle of data, in fact, is what machines would be receiving from their environment, from their world. As we've moved forward, machines have gotten much more data. So essentially, the world is starting to become full of data. We've gone from a small trickle of data from a single source to a vast cascade of data, often from a single source. But what we've even moved farther than this. So very recently, we moved to the domain where now we don't just have data coming from a single source en masse. We have data coming from many, many different places, all at the same time, but at different rates and with different volumes. So the key idea here that I want you to take away, I'll put up some key ideas for the duration of the talk, but the key idea from this piece is that think about data now being ubiquitous. Data is everywhere, and it flows between connected systems with both high volume and also with great diversity. Is that everyone's tracking? Great. So this leads us into the topic of this particular talk, which is machine intelligence. So when you have this vast sea of data or this flood of data, a fire hose. Richard Sutton likes to call it a fire hose of data, and I think that's a fairly good analogy. Machine intelligence is one technique that's been put forward as a way of dealing with this data. So why machine intelligence? Why should you care? Why should society care in general? One is that machine intelligence promises enhanced control. And here I mean enhanced control over a world that's getting progressively wilder and more chaotic and harder for us to understand unless we break it down into little pieces. Machine intelligence also promises anticipation. So ever since the dawn of time, people have been, you know, rolling the knuckle bones of animals and things and trying to predict the future. Predicting the future has been pretty key to most societies on the planet, and machine intelligence actually is one tool that maybe allows us to predict the future. Now, maybe this isn't what's going to happen in detail for detail over the next 20 years, but for small periods of time or for specific questions, machine intelligence really does give us the ability to anticipate, to predict outcomes and predict the future. But more brought together, machine intelligence promises general tools for solving very hard problems. So I've written down here, this is an excerpt from my cheat sheet, but the excerpt here is optimizing the control of complex systems and extracting knowledge from massive amounts of data. So these two themes are going to sort of come up over and over again over the course of the talk, but one is being able to intelligently and perhaps even very skillfully optimize some kind of control system, and the other is to find ways to make sense of all that wild data, to do something with knowledge. Now, I think I could, at this point, share with you all sorts of examples from finance, from healthcare, the energy sectors, but I'm just going to pass this over. We can talk more in the question session if you'd like specific examples. But there are many, many realms where machine intelligence not only has promise, but has already been deployed. In fact, you're probably using a lot of them. I'm sure some of you have things like smartphones, and some of you use the internet. I imagine one or two of you use the internet. Yes? Yeah? Okay, good. Good. Otherwise, this would be rather tricky. But so machine intelligence has already been deployed. But there's a problem. So normally when I noticed the title of this particular stream of the course is called The Perils and Promises of Artificial Intelligence. Well, a lot of things people mean a lot of things when they say artificial intelligence. And more generally, there's many terms used to define an intelligent system. Now, in this case, I've listed three here that I find particularly interesting. One is, of course, artificial intelligence. And usually when I hear people say artificial intelligence, I sort of in my head turn that into non-human intelligence or non-biological intelligence. So I would say that, you know, intelligence is intelligence. There's nothing artificial about it. But let's look at it as it's standardly used. Artificial intelligence. We have machine learning, which is something we have a world-class machine learning center here. So we obviously must deal with machine learning. And then we have things like pattern recognition or pattern analysis. So let's just attack each one very, very briefly. So artificial intelligence. Does it actually need to learn? Most people, when they think of intelligent systems, they think that these systems are, you know, able to learn, able to integrate new knowledge into themselves. But often, in some cases, in much of the classical AI, you'll find a very strong and powerful computational system, but there's no actual ongoing learning. The system will be able to give you good answers to things, but it might not learn. Now let's drop down to machine learning. I can propose for you, and I may even show you later in this talk, several examples of machine learning that you would argue, well, that's not really that intelligent. You can have a system that will learn, a machine that will learn, that might not sort of pass your definition of intelligence. And at the very bottom here, we have things like pattern recognition and pattern analysis. Be able to look at some complex wild pattern and tell you something about it, or make some kind of assessment or classification on that pattern. Well, I mean, you could almost think of that as very much a mechanical, a deterministic process. Is that really intelligent? No, I don't know. I'm not going to answer that question for you. That's something that I'm hoping you're all going to think about. But let's move on to perhaps one possible definition. And now I'm going to roll all these things together, and even roll machine intelligence, into intelligent systems. So for now, let's actually just speak precisely about intelligent systems. So now here we can, this is what I'm going to put forward for you today, and we're going to explore this more over the course of the talk. But I say one possible definition is that an intelligent system is a system that can actually take in its world, perceive and represent some facets of its world. That this kind of system can make predictions about its world. And predictions are maybe another word for facts. You know, it can actually have some kind of hold some kind of facts about its world and make some kind of forecasts about how that world will behave. And the last line here, so down at the bottom here, is control its world. So use all of these things, use this, let's say, knowledge, to be able to exert some kind of influence in the world. Or if you want to think about it just as a stream of experience entering an intelligent system, be able to perform actions and see some kind of corresponding change into that stream of information flowing into it. So there's two more pieces here that I'd like to draw in. So one of them is actually from William James, and this is going all the way back down to 1890. And here, here this particular quote speaks to purposefulness. So that if you want to think of something as having a mind, then maybe you need to think of it as pursuing some kind of future ends and being able to choose the means by which it goes to attack those ends. And Rich Sutton, much more quickly and much more recently, would say that really intelligent systems should probably have, seek, and achieve goals. And I think, in fact, Rich wouldn't say probably, he would say that they should. But let's pull all these together. So here's another key idea. So I'll put another exclamation point slide here. So this key idea is saying that intelligence revolves around maintaining and using knowledge. And by this, by knowledge, let's talk about representation, prediction, and control. And about doing this in a purposeful way. All right? So we're using and maintaining knowledge and doing so in a purposeful way. So for now, for the sake of discussion, let's hold that as our idea of an intelligent system, and then we can smash it around and beat it up a bit later on during the question session. Okay, so I talked about learning. So I may have mentioned that, well, you know, an intelligent system might not need to learn, but usually we think about it as a learning system. So why learning? Why do we actually need a system to learn? I'm just going to throw three ideas up here. I like threes and fives are good numbers. So let's look at three. One idea is that things are unknown. So I've got let's say we have a start here. Oh, I said star, but we have a start here. We have an end here. And we may not know how we can get between that start and that end. So we know our ends, but the means to get there are unclear. Learning can help us attack this problem. Things are complex. So even if we do sort of know how we might get there, it could be that as the world gets more complex, scaling up a system is demanding or impossible. Being able to deal with large amounts of complexity is another realm where learning gives us an advantage. And lastly, things change. So systems need to adapt. And this is one of the stellar areas for learning, and one of the areas where it really shines, is the ability to adapt and change, for a system to be able to take on new information and really flexibly shift the way that it predicts and controls the world in response to changes in real time. So these are just three areas where we might actually need learning. And so here's your key idea. And the key idea for this little chunk is that I'm going to propose to you that our ability to directly engineer a system, and by this I mean an intelligent system, actually no longer scales up to the goals we have for our technology. I especially think here of many medical technologies, and also to just the general complexity of the digital world that we live in. So we can't go out there and hand design something that will solve the problem we need to solve. Learning is a tool that allows us to solve these more complex, more ambitious problems. Okay, so let's move on to what to learn. So I said we sort of addressed, you know, why you might care about machine intelligence, how we might even go about defining machine intelligence and intelligent systems. But now let's dive right into the meat of it. So we're going to explore, as I mentioned earlier, what you might want to learn using an intelligent system or a machine intelligence or a machine learning system, how you might want to go about acquiring that kind of knowledge, and then when you might want to do that, or how you would actually deploy this kind of learning system. So these are the three big ideas, and we're going to look at this from all angles, kind of like your faceted gemstone. We're going to roll it around a bit, see how the light goes through it, and hopefully by the end of this, you'll come out with instead of being able to put things in defined buckets, I'm hoping that you'll be able to see that there's a number of interchangeable and connected ways that a machine learning system could go about building up, maintaining, and using knowledge. Sound good? Everyone's with me? Good. Nodding and smiling. I like that. Okay, so what to learn. In terms of what to learn today, there are many things you could learn, but I'm going to break down three of the most important classes. One is prediction learning. So here we're talking about building up knowledge, building up facts about your world. Control learning. So this is actually using the knowledge you have to act. And representation learning, structuring knowledge or structuring your perceptions. All right, so those are the three we're going to tackle. Let's first look at prediction learning. And so a common example in prediction learning is, for some reason, rainfall analysis. Everyone must really want to predict rainfall. I'm not sure why. But I'll stick with the trend and actually look at this. So now imagine that you have a time series, kind of like what I've shown here. So essentially you have Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. You have about a span of a whole week here. And every day the bars indicate how much rain is going to fall. We haven't seen them yet. This is what's going to happen. I'm showing you the future. And we have an intelligent system. And the goal of our intelligent system here is to predict. So remember I said you might want to learn several different things? Here we're learning to predict, or we may wish to be able to predict. So we have an intelligent system which is going to predict for us the rainfall, in this case, on one time step, on the next day. Okay, this is one kind of prediction, saying, given that I'm in a current situation, I want to know immediately what's going to happen next, or predict some fact about the next thing that I'm going to see. So in this example, our learning system sees all the information about Monday. Maybe it sees the cloud cover on Monday. It knows how much rain fell on Monday. Maybe it has the barometric pressure, all these things about Monday. It knows things about Monday. And it uses those Mondayisms to actually try and say something about Tuesday. And here you see I put a little red line which says prediction of 7 millimeters. So here it says, based on what I've seen of Monday and what I've known from the past, well, I think there's probably going to be 7 millimeters of rain on Tuesday. And here you see, there's my little gray number here actually says that there's going to be 8. So instead it's pretty close. There's a small error, and we can use that error to actually correct its predictions later on. But we're going to gloss that over for now and just talk about making predictions. So, as you probably expect, on Tuesday you can use all those Tuesdayisms, and you can say something about Wednesday. You're making a prediction about what's going to happen on the immediately next observation. And you can use the difference between what you predict and what you get to actually change how you think. Okay, these are reasonable things. But you know what? You don't have to just take into account information on Tuesday when looking at Wednesday. You have a history. So you could also use data from both Monday and Tuesday. You could use information about the rainfall on Monday, Tuesday, barometric pressure, cloud cover, maybe to get a better expectation about Wednesday. In fact, you could use historical data from years and years. And this is sometimes what we actually do when you see people making forecasts about things like rainfall. And now you see that the prediction from the system actually matches what you're going to get. You get 9 millimeters. Okay, so this is, when people talk about predictions, they often talk about this kind of prediction. Is that bad? No, this is good. These are really functional, useful kinds of predictions. But often people neglect a different kind of prediction, which is a temporally extended prediction. A prediction about what's going to happen in some way over a longer period of time. So this is, again, this is less explored. But another relevant question was, given that it's Monday, let's say, anyone here are avid gardeners? Do you guys garden? Okay, we have at least two gardeners. My wife and I both really love gardening. And so now you can imagine that we're gardening and things, and maybe it's planting, or maybe we're planning to show our garden or something. We may care about how much rain is going to fall over the course of an entire week. You know, we could just say, you know, it's Monday, but we have to, like, you know, show off our garden the next Monday, or we're planning to do something out in the garden next Monday, and we don't want it to be too soggy. So we want our intelligent system. Let's say we're like, garden, tell me how much rain you expect over the whole next week, not just on the next day, but over a series of observations. So now here you see I've actually got the prediction. Now it says something about, come here, it's a little red dot. So now it's a summation. So you could say, you could learn to predict, you could hope to predict the summation over a number of different examples. Here, equally weighted. It says, I just want to just total up the rain that falls in my rain gauge over the week. But that's not the only class of temporal extension you could think of. There's all sorts of ways you could weight the future, weight how much you care about future predictions. So here, the red does show up on the board. Good. So here you might see that, okay, we know that actually the garden show, let's say we grow lilies. So let's say it's a lily show. And there's a lily show on Saturday and Sunday. So, and we actually have to show our flowers. Now, we might really care the sum total of the rain that's going to fall on Saturday and Sunday. This could be really important to us. And just for preparation reasons, you know, we might care a little bit about how much rain falls on Thursday and Friday. So now you could expect a learning system to be able to predict some weighted function of future examples. By weighted function here, I actually mean, you know, we want it to predict that there'd be exactly 2 millimeters of rain that will fall on Saturday and Sunday, and then some function of Thursday and Friday. Not quite as important. And maybe it'll come up with something like 5.5 millimeters over that period, given that we care more about Saturday and Sunday. Right? So these I just want to make sure this is clear. So there's lots of ways you could predict. But the two that I think are at least important for broaching the subject are predicting exactly what's going to happen next or in the next sample you see, and then predicting something about the future, weighted in some way, spread out over that future. And that could be contingent on how you're acting, whether or not I choose to show my lilies or whether I choose to, you know, show our snapdragons or something. All right? Not that anyone I think shows snapdragons, but let's pretend. All right? Is that good? Two types of things. Okay, let's look at control learning. So we may wish to learn how to build up facts or knowledge about our world. Now, we may want to also know how to act in a world. So here the example is that we have an intelligent system, and that intelligent system behaves according to some policy. The policy is really a way of taking information and choosing actions. So here I denote it pi. All right? So it starts out in this start state. So it started out in this one location, and it's going to start walk towards the right. It's going to go to location 1 and then have to decide whether to go to location 2 or location 3. So let's actually do that. So our intelligence system takes a step over. It's in location 1. All right? And it has to decide now. It knows that the road is branched, and it can decide on the road less traveled, but it doesn't know which one that is. So at this point, it has to say, should I go to location 2? Or should I go to location 3? Or maybe even should I stay at the location I'm at and wait a little while to figure things out? All right? So what's one way that you might want to actually go about making that choice? Here, this is on the bottom. I'm going to give this one right away. But on the bottom, you could do it based on some kind of model you've learned about the world, some kind of structure you've stored that tells you how you think the world works, or some values about different places in the world. All right? You could have a model, or you could have some valuation of different parts of this wild, squishy world. So here, let's actually look at value. So let's say that over the either because someone engineered this into the system or because it learned this, let's say that it knows that it expects location 2 to be worth $55. It goes there, someone's going to hand it a check for $55. And if it goes down to location 3, somebody's going to hit it over the head with something heavy and take its wallet, and it will lose $10. Let's say this is the example. So it's using information that it has about the value of location 2 and location 3 to make its choice. So it'll probably do something like this. Well, negative 10 is bad if it values money, and plus $55 is probably good. So, you know, it might say, my clear choice here, my control policy would be to take the highest value I can get, so I'm going to go to location 2. And that's exactly what it does. So this is one way of making control choices. We could hope for our intelligent system to be able to learn how to value the world in different ways, or how to learn a model of the world such that it can use that model in planning and decision making. Okay, good. So the other aspect is here, well, we don't really always have to keep around that model. We don't really have to keep around an extensive list of all the possible places in the world. The other way we could do it is say, well, remember I said we have this policy. Policy being essentially some thing that you have that tells you, given the information you see, how should you go about acting in the world? So what we could do is hope that we don't have to learn all the models, we could just learn a good policy. We hope that over the course of our experience, our system would be able to learn the best policy for any given place in the world, the best actions to take in any given situation, without having to consider the options or do some rollouts or do any planning. So in this case, you could say, well, again, we're back in location 1, and it has to decide, do I go to location 2? Do I go to location 3? And here, it could just take in information about location 1. Again, maybe cloud cover, barometric pressure, how many trees there are, is there a tiger? Is there a tiger in my current location? It could take in any features, any information about location 1 that it's currently seen, maybe even some of its past places, to sort of say, should I take action 1 or should I take action 2? All right. So in this case, it could even be it could be probabilistic. You could have a random chance of which way you go, but you might want to weight it towards location 2. And then it moves towards location 2. So those are two different doorways on control learning. You might hope that it learns a model of the world and uses that model to plan. And you might hope that a system will be able to learn a good policy such that it can see its immediate circumstances and take the right action or make the right decision at the right time. So these are, again, two different doorways. So let's look at representation learning, and I won't spend as much time here, but we'll look at it through the lens of simplifying the data. So here, representation is perhaps how you'd go about taking all those signals from your wild, squishy world and concretely representing that or simplifying it into a form that you could use it to communicate to someone else, to make decisions, or as a basis for learning. All right, so here's a really simple example where you have an input pattern. You have an intelligent system, and it spits out an output pattern. And what we're seeing here is that there are ways that you could take that input pattern and turn it into a simpler output pattern which doesn't lose any information. Who likes compression? Who has zip files and JPEGs? Yeah, exactly. So this is when I talk about representation, I also talk about things like, how do you do effective compression? These are actually hallmarks of something kind of intelligent, though, if you think about it. Recognizing patterns in the structure of data and being able to simplify the data based on it, that's kind of cool and wild. But let's look at this example. So you see this input pattern. So we've got our input pattern over here. We've got our output pattern. So one way to simplify this would be for your intelligent system to realize, well, you know what, if you just sort of break this up into chunks of three, then you can just say three zeros is equal to 1 0, three ones is equal to 1 1, and you know what? Wow, amazing. You were able to turn that longer string into a smaller string. Maybe then you can use that for something else, something useful. So we might hope that a system would learn effective ways to do that kind of translation, to simplify or find and understand the structure in the data and communicate the important bits. Here's another example, actually, with some of my own data from an abstract we're submitting at the end of the week. But you might have, instead of having a bit stream coming in, maybe you have a bunch of wild, woolly, real-valued signals. They look kind of like fuzzy caterpillars. So you might have like 3 or 4 fuzzy caterpillars. You might have 1,000 fuzzy caterpillars. And what you might hope is that that intelligent system could find a way to simplify those into some, maybe even a single, like a pulse, like the one I have out here, like a neural firing train. Something like that. That you could actually simplify all these signals into another signal which represents the important information in that first signal. Okay? So this is not like bits. Now we're talking about real analog signals that go up and down in things. Maybe you have to sample them. But you could also translate it into symbols. So just because you're going from one space to another space, they don't have to be the same space. Maybe this intelligent system, we'd like it to be able to go from all these continuous signals over to a string of symbols. Maybe one for each time step, maybe one to each for each block of experience in those wiggly wild signals. All right? And was that my last example? Oh, okay, all right. So we're going on to how to learn. Is everyone tracking? Does anyone have any questions on what you might want to learn? No? We're good? Okay. So this is the fun bit, because now I actually get to, you know, have pictures and things, and I get to interact a bit more. So how to learn. There's all sorts of ways that people have proposed that for a machine system to be able to learn things about its world or about the data they're giving it. And we'd be here probably until sometime the year after next if I were to go through each one in detail. So I'm going to boil down what are typically considered the three major classes. And they have names that people like to use for them, but I'm not going to use those names. I'm going to hopefully tell you what I think they actually mean. So one method for learning is learning from labeled examples. Learning from a pair of experience and a label that matches it. And I'll demonstrate this in the context of prediction learning, so we'll have a little chat about that. The next is finding structure in the data, working with the structure of the data. And I already touched on this, but I'll talk about that in the context of representation learning. And I promise, a very, very simple example in that case. And lastly, when we're looking at, in the context of control learning, I'll sort of hopefully give you some insight into how something might learn through trial and error, through experience with the world. All right, so we're going to again go for three possibilities here, and we'll look at each one in turn. So the first example here, I'm actually going now it's quiz time. So we have a learning system, we have an input channel, and this input channel in this case is a picture. All right, so we have an image, and the learning system's job is to tell you, does this picture come from Japan, from Iceland, or from Argentina? So it's got three output channels. One of them will go active. So now you're the learning system. You tell me, where did this image come from? Argentina? Ooh. So in this case, this one actually came from Iceland. That's Dettifoss. Now this was a bit of a quick test, because I actually showed all three. I showed this particular image at the beginning along with its label pair, and I was going to see who was going to sort of pick this up. But yeah, so this is it's hard to see from the size. I realized from the size and the darkness of the screen. But in this case, it actually came from Iceland. So now if the learning system guessed Argentina, which is a reasonable guess. Lots of waterfalls in Argentina, and quite a few of them are pretty big, especially once you get up towards the Brazil end. So now the learning system would essentially say, I guessed Argentina. I've been told, like I just told all of you, that the true label for this particular sample is Iceland. All right? So now what it's going to do is, you can see I drew some red lines in here in the learning network itself. So now the system is actually going to change its internal structure. It's going to change the way that it maps inputs to outputs, such that it's more likely to say Iceland next time it saw that particular picture, and it's less likely to say Argentina. There's all sorts of fun math we can talk about for how you might want to do that and different ways to structure the learning system, but the key point here is that you have a you have an input sample, you make a guess about the label for that sample, and then you're told specifically what the true label should have been, and use the difference between these two to change your behavior. Again, this is like a multiple choice test. You have an exam, you guess A, you get the answer key, it says B. Next time you're more likely to pick A, or whatever A stands for. So this is, I think, pretty good. So let's keep going. You guys are good? So, okay, now where's this one? Argentina is correct. Good. So in this case, this is Iguazu Falls in Argentina, also one of our labeled examples from the first three slides of the talk. So in Argentina here, now that was a correct guess. So now the learning system may reinforce those weights or reinforce its internal structures such that, yeah, next time it sees something like this, it's actually going to give you that same answer. It'll say Argentina again next time. Okay, so last one in this particular one. Where's this? Someone else this time. Japan? Well, in this case, it's Iceland again. So I gave you three. So this isn't one of the three examples that were shown at the beginning. And I did that on purpose to highlight an extra point, is that it's not just matching an exact pattern. That's possible. But what's usually done is that there are features of an image. So the system will be using, it will likely never see the two samples exactly the same way. So it can use features. So in this case, you might notice that there's sort of a gray hovering sky, and maybe you notice that there's some boulders and jagged rocks around, and that it doesn't look like there's any tropical foliage, and maybe you don't see any red buildings or something like this. So you can guess that based on those features, that it might be more like Iceland. So now it's not that you're reinforcing the exact pattern. You were actually going in and changing the internal structure of the learning system so that when it sees those features, when it sees those different facets of the world, it's more likely to come up with the correct label, right? And you can imagine this I've shown you this example for photographs. That's going to be sort of the theme for this. But you can also imagine for medical data. You could say, is this particular region of an image a tumor or not a tumor? This is a classification kind of problem. And then afterwards, you can have a physician go in and actually assign that label and say yes or no. There's all sorts of examples I can give, but let's let this rest for now. Is everyone sort of clear on how that works? Yeah? Good. Okay. So you see an input pattern, you make a guess, you see the output, and you're told the true answer, and then you change yourself so that you're more likely to give the true answer in the future. You're told the true answer. Okay? All right. Let's look at finding structure in the data. So this goes back towards our representation learning example, but now your job is to make two groupings. Now remember, we talked just recently, in fact on the last slide, we talked about features, about using features. So now there are all sorts of features you can imagine extracting from an image or from the data associated with an image. So here, I'm going to pose it to you guys. So make two groupings. You have image A and B. It's pretty simple that you're going to make probably A is going to be different than B. You have two groupings, right? So let's move on. Let's add C. Now you still need to make two groupings. So would someone tell me, how would you group these images? Which would you group together? You need to make two groups. What's that? You group A and C together. Why would you group A and C together? Ah, okay, great. So there's a feature in the image. In this case, you've pulled out the feature glasses. And now you've looked at the spectrum of possible values for that feature, everywhere from, let's say, having glasses to not having glasses. You've drawn a separator line based on that value, based on that feature. And now you've said, okay, so the guy in the middle, who happens to be Richard Sutton, is in his own cluster, and you're making a grouping out of A and C. That's good. All right, let's add another character on here. Now, how would you make your groupings? You still have to make two groupings. Gender. Okay. So this is another feature that you could extract, or that you might know from the data associated with your sample here. So I'm assuming that means you're proposing we do A, B, and D together, and then C goes out. Is that right? Yeah, so that's a reasonable thing to do as well. So these are, the point here, and I'm going to show you a couple other examples. So one, you could say beards versus no beards. So you may notice that the two on the left do not have beards, and the two on the right have no beards, and the two on the left have beards. You could also say no visible teeth in the picture, and then visible teeth. You can probably see that from there. These are all reasonable things. Or lastly, you could say not Patrick's mother and Patrick's mother. So I don't know if any of you have run into my mother. She's a professor over in oncology here, Linda Pilarski, but that's a reasonable grouping too, but not based on really features of the data, based on the metadata associated with that picture. So this is neat though. So really, it's up to the learning system. I didn't tell you guys a measure by which I wanted you to split these. The system can use structure in the features, structure in the data, to begin to separate this out and make clusters, make groupings. This is one example of representation learning. You can imagine then using this kind of classification instead of giving the image itself to a learning system or to some other learning system or to even a human user, you could now just give them a label. Not Patrick's mother, Patrick's mother. Head of the course for LabMed 590, not exactly. So there's all these different ways you could split on this data. Is that cool? Does everyone understand that? Okay, so this is a way of finding the structure in the data and doing it by yourself without someone coming in saying, no, this is the right way to make those clusters. You can do that. And there's fusions of these two. There's a whole field of active learning where, you know, the system might try and cluster some things and it said, you know, I need you to tell me what class I should put this other picture in. I don't know if it's Patrick's mother or not Patrick's mother. It's like it's some strange image I've never seen. And the human actually has to come in and for a small subset of those examples, actually label it for the system. But most of the time, the system learns by itself. There's all sorts of gray areas between the canonical examples I'm showing you, and that's important to remember. But let's go even farther and let's go into trial and error learning. All right, so this is more the field of things like reinforcement learning, which is near and dear to my heart. But let's move to trial and error. So I'm going to set this one up at a bit more length for you. So I'm going to give you a little bit more background on this. Imagine that you're a photographer. All right, you're a new photographer in the photography industry. You got hired on by a magazine editor to shoot awesome travel photography for their magazine. All right, so that's your job. So you, as the learning system, your goal, your purpose, or your focus, is to shoot good photos that will be given to your editor at the magazine, and in exchange, the editor will give you a bonus. So you probably get a salary or something like that, but in exchange for good photos, you're almost like a photographic mercenary, you're going to get money in exchange for good photos, all right? And if you're not one of those people who's driven by money, then maybe assume that editor will give you an extra so many percent on this course as you shoot the good photos. You can pick whatever measure in the world that is important to you, that is given to you by the outside world. But for here, let's say money. All right, so your learning system, and you have to make a choice. You can either go to location 1, location 2, or location 3. Now, we're not going to make the choice yet because it's important to state one more thing about this. Earlier we talked about making actions based on some model or some way of valuing the world. So in this case, I've just put a little box up here in the corner of each one here, and that's how much your current expectations, your current hypothesis about how much money you're going to get for going to each of those locations, or how good it is to go to each of those locations. So we're not starting at zero. You're a fairly optimistic person. You know, you expect to get units of dollars, but probably thousands of dollars. You expect to get $2 for each of those locations, for the photos you shoot each of those locations. This is the knowledge you start with, the knowledge you move into it with. So based on this, it's pretty even, right? Like, you have no real reason for choosing one location over another location, except maybe personal preference, but let's assume we take that out. At this point, you just know that you value all of these three locations equally, and now you need to go and explore. You actually have to go there, take your camera, shoot some photos, all right? So now I wish I could actually get you guys to choose the door. If I had a more flexible app, I could, but because I've made the slides in advance, we're gonna just say we go to door 2. Is that all right? Is everyone okay with that? Otherwise, I can spend the next 15 minutes rearranging the slides. No? You okay? Good. All right. So here, let's say that your learning system chooses action 2. It chooses to go to location 2, which turns out to be Argentina. See a theme arising here. I don't want to use more than three kinds of photos. So we go to Argentina. All right. So at that point, we are in a certain situation. That situation is being back home. We take an action. That action takes us to another location. It takes us to another state in the world. And then based on that, we're also going to find out how well we did. We shoot some pictures, right? You go, you take all of your pictures, you go back, you hand them to your editor. Your editor gives you $5. Hey, that's cool. Maybe that's $5,000. Pick your scale as well. So what you do is you actually take that $5 you got, and now you update your expectation. You update the value that you've assigned to that particular location. You got $5 the first time you went. Well, it's pretty reasonable to assume you might get something like $5 next time you go, right? So it's not always true. But for this example, let's assume you just update it to exactly what you saw. But there's ways you can keep this in your mind. There are ways that you can think of amalgamating successive experiences such that you don't just take the last thing you saw, but that you're more reasoned and principled about things. You don't run an experiment once and then say, well, obviously that was the result of the experiment. You run an experiment many, many, many times, and you find out the expectation. You find out what you can realistically expect under the natural distribution of the world, how the world works. But here, we're just going to do this once. So let's say you update it. Your value of this location is now 5. All right? And we go back home. So we've gone back to our initial state, and now we have to decide where we're going to go next. So if you were, now I'm going to ask a question. We'll do what I have in my slides, but I'm going to ask a question anyway. So if you were this learning system, what would you do? What location would you choose? Given the values you have and perhaps something else in your head, what would you choose?
Go back to the same place.
You go back to the same place. Okay, so this is the very natural choice. It makes sense. Everything else is 2, that one's 5. The rational choice would be go back to 5 and just keep doing that until for some reason it doesn't look as good as the others, right? So this is good. And this is in fact what most policies will do. But there's a chance that you're wrong about those other 2, right? There's a chance you're wrong. So this slides into, I'm rolling a lot into this last section, but this slides into the idea of exploration versus exploitation during learning. So a certain amount of the time, you want to go out and explore to see if something is better. And a certain fraction of the time, you want to be doing the best known thing, right? I mean, you there's a chance that going to one of those places will give you something good, but then there's a chance that you know you can get good stuff in this one place, right? So, but let's say that we actually try to explore and we go to 3. All right, 3 turns out to be Japan. We haven't actually seen Japan yet, so this is good. We go to Japan, we start taking a lot of photographs in Japan, and our editor gives us $1. You know what? Turns out our editor isn't a real fan of red buildings. There's a lot of red buildings in Japan. I spend a lot of time in Japan, and I can vouch for it. There's a lot of red buildings. So we only get $1 for that one, so we update our expectation. You know, 2 was a bit optimistic. We didn't know this about the world, so now we value it as 5 and a 1. All right, so we go back to our base, and I think we probably know what's going to happen next. If we were rational people, we'd still take the 5, but let's explore one more time just so we've seen each one. There's all sorts of really well-bounded, theoretically guaranteed methods for exploring and exploiting in different situations, and some of those can be leveraged. But for today, we're going to do random exploration of things we haven't seen. And it turns out to be Iceland, which would have been good. I love Iceland. I've taken lots of pictures in Iceland. But this time, we actually decide to go on an adventure. And, you know, we get in a super jeep, we're going into the interior, we lose some of our camera equipment, we come home, and we don't actually have any photographs. We went on a tour all over Iceland. We saw all sorts of things, but not only do we lose camera gear and have to pay for new gear, our editor is pissed and we don't get any money for that particular trip. So that's negative 10. That wasn't that good, was it? We should never explore, should we? Huh. So we update our valuation to say, okay, well, that one's going to be a negative 10. So going back here, I think now we can say, okay, assuming that those expectations, assuming that every time we go to Japan, we only get pictures of red buildings, and assuming that every time we go to Iguazu Falls, we get that great $5 shot, and every time we go to Iceland, we go on an adventure and lose money. If that's all true, now we know what to do. For the rest of time, we can just keep picking at Iguazu Falls and taking lots of photos. Is there another way to do this? Is there a different way to choose your actions? And so I think for the sort of final big concept I'm going to try and bring in is the difference between extrinsic versus intrinsic motivation. So I think, can we all agree that money and grades and things are kind of, they're extrinsic. There's something that is given to you from the outside and that you try and work towards, right? Grades. I'm assuming some of you work towards grades, and you probably care about them a bit, but do you really care about the number? Do you really care about the learning? Oh, show of hands. Who cares about the number grade you get in the course? Okay, good. Someone's on. Okay, who cares about the learning? And you can actually pick both. I'm not making you choose. But so this is, it's important, though, that these are 2 facets that are not just, they're not just in your world. They're also in the world of machine intelligence. There's a whole field of something called computational curiosity. Finding ways to use intrinsic motivation to drive the behavior of a learning system. That sounds wild, doesn't it? You're like, machines being curious? Machines using, like, their own desire to learn to drive how they act in the world? That's kind of wild. But it's not actually that wild. So we had that first value function up at the top here. Remember I showed you like the negative 10, the 5, the 1? That's your expectations of how much money you're going to get by going to any of these places. On the bottom here, let's add another row. And maybe in that row, you store how much your internal system has changed. Remember in the example of learning from labeled examples, we talked about how you could have a labeled example, and then you got the true example, and then you'd change yourself. You'd update your internal structure of your learning system in accordance to that pairing. Well, here, imagine you kept track of that. Kept track of how much you updated your internal parameters, and then used that as another function. Just keep track of that. Now you could say something like, well, I could either choose to behave in a way that takes me to where I'll get the most money, or I can choose to behave in a way that takes me to where I'm making the most learning progress. The most learning. So now you see here that, well, Japan actually was 3. I learned my editor didn't like red buildings. Oh, that's actually a lot of learning. I had to change my internal mapping from features to actions and things like that. So you maybe learned a bit more. Iguazu Falls, I just took pictures. I learned 2. I learned that I get $5 from it. In Iceland, even though I lost my camera gear, we went on an entire tour all the way around Iceland and I could see where I could take really good pictures. I did a ton of internal learning. I changed my internal structure a lot, the way that I map my features to other features even. So you could have some measure of your learning and use that learning progress to drive your system's behavior. And in that case, you'd probably want to go and take Iceland again. Even though last time you went there, you lost a ton of money, you might want to go back there because that's the place where you have the potential to learn the most. This is kind of cool. We have robots in our lab that actually deploy these kind of systems. They'll smash into the wall a couple of times until they've sort of learned everything they can about smashing into that wall, and then they'll sort of start spinning and things. They'll find ways to keep doing an action or keep exploring part of the world until the learning progress diminishes to the point where it's more fruitful to go explore a different part of the world. I think this is what we do as scientists, and it's some what we do as human beings moving through the world. It's something that I think is very central to intelligent systems. Be able to use both internal and external drives to determine how we behave in a purposeful way in the environment. So let's move into the last chunk. So I've got one last chunk, I promised you. It's going to be a little bit faster than that last one. I wanted to really hammer home on how you might learn, because that's where you can get the intuition on all those other techniques. So before I go there, we had 3 things, right? Ever remember our 3 examples in the last one? Learning from labeled examples, finding structure in the data, and then learning through trial and error, smashing yourself in the world and seeing what happens. So now we're going to the setting of when to learn. And I'm just going to talk about 2 examples here because they're a good way to divide the space, again, unsupervised clustering. In this case, you could either learn in real time during ongoing experience. You could have a learning system that learns while it's out there bumping and smashing into the world. Or you could do something like learn from past experience. You could collect a bunch of data, collect a bunch of information, and then you could use that while you're back home resting to learn about things and to change yourself. So let's look first actually at that offline learning case. Learning from past experience. Okay, so here you might imagine we have a sort of a trail here. I've sort of structured them loosely like genetic data. You have your A's, G's, T's, and C's, no uracil. Samples of experience going this way, and we have our learning system. So in the offline setting, we might do something like this. We might step through and collect the first sample, second sample, third sample. We keep getting samples of experience. They might be sequenced in time. They might just be a big bucket of data that was handed to us from someone at the clinic or from some database somewhere. So we get all those samples of experience. We're not doing anything yet. We're just acquiring samples of experience. We can then use those samples of experience to update the learning systems. Now all of that data, all that information is somehow smashed together, boiled down, sort of stirred up in a big pot, and used to alter our learning system, to change the internal structure of our learning system. There's all sorts of names for that internal structure. But here, just think about it, you're changing almost the knowledge, changing the way you predict and the way you control. You're changing the internal structure of the system. And more often than not, you do this several times. You take that same chunk of data, that same batch of data, and you smash it into your learning system several times and update it according to that data. Right? So this is a common example. Now you can have a stream of new experience. And when you see that new experience in, your learning system can use all of that previous learning, all of the experience it gained from analyzing that giant bucket of old data, and use that to make predictions about each of these new labels. So here you can see it sees this particular example, and maybe he's binding energy or something. It says, oh, that's got to be a GE. It's got to be a GE, a T, and this has got to be a C. All right? So that's one way of learning from your past experience. Other names are offline learning or perhaps batch learning. Now, there's ways you can use batch learning while a system's going out and bumping around and smashing into the world. But for now, just think about this is one predominant approach. Used a lot in data mining, used a lot in informatics, biomedical systems. Essentially, you have a gigantic database, maybe collected at hundreds of different hospitals. You're taking all that amassed data, you're throwing that into a learning system, and at the end, there's smoke, there's explosions, there's lightning in the sky, someone cackles, and then at the end, you hold up this perfect machine learning system, and you take that out, and you put it in a device, and you put it in the clinic, and that device will then say, healthy, sick, don't know. Essentially, you're boiling down data to help give you a finished product. This isn't always how it works, but that's one of the predominant approaches to using offline or batch learning. There's other good ways you can do it, again, in online learning. But now let's look at real-time learning. This is something I'm particularly passionate about because there's all sorts of tricky unsolved problems and also all sorts of ways to really exploit the advantages of machine learning. So remember earlier I said one of the big why would we learn? Why did we learn? Let's go back. Quiz time. Why are the three reasons we might want to use learning as opposed to just a hand design system? Yeah, so things might be wild unknown. What were some of the other ones? What are three reasons why we might want to learn as opposed to something else? We had things are unknown as one of the answers. Yeah, things might get wild and woolly and we have to be able to deal with that. And the last one? Systems need to adapt. And that hits right back here. Real-time learning is how we've been deploying real-time learning is to allow systems to adapt. And the next time I talk to you guys, I'll talk more about this because we've been deploying it in terms of artificial limbs, prosthetic systems, allowing an artificial limb or a robotic system smacked right onto your body to begin to know things about you while you're using it, build up knowledge about you, and improve the way it interacts with you. So there's advantages to real-time learning, and you can guess that I really like it. However, I did my entire PhD in offline or batch learning, so I'm also really excited about that. I just do a lot of real-time learning now. So real-time learning, same samples of experience. But here, we see our first sample, and immediately use it to update our learning system. We see a sample, it updates the structure of our learning system. Likewise for the next sample. We see the next sample, and it's immediately smashed into our learning system. Again and again. Okay, so one point about this is incremental. As our system acquires data, it's using it to change its internal structure. So why is that good? How is that different? Are there any ways it's different? So there's all sorts of fun mathematical reasons why these are the same and why they're different. But the important thing here is that at point A, I can make a prediction about that next time step. I could do that one time step prediction we talked about earlier on. I could say that, well, based on my earlier experiences, C's are about here and this is about here, so I'm going to label this C, which is in fact the case. So you can be, this is equally applicable to control policies. So if you're learning to control, you're learning how to take your situation in the world and pick an action or make a decision. Well, if you could, you know, if you're in a thorn thicket or something like that, you're running through a thorn thicket and there's like, you know, suddenly you can see like deer trails and you wonder, do deer trails help me get out of my thorn thicket? You take one deer trail, well, you can then know that you should, and you get out of your thorn thicket, you can immediately get out of your next thorn thicket and the next thorn thicket. You don't have to scratch yourself for another 30 or 40 examples before you can get out of that first thicket. So that perhaps is a more complex example than needed, but the main point is that you can use experience that you get immediately. And you can essentially keep incrementally or progressively updating your learning structure without having to wait for the end to come. Because in true intelligent systems, is there going to be a defined end of learning? Does that make sense? No. I see at least one head shaking. It doesn't really make sense. If you have a persistent intelligent system, if you have what people usually think when they think of artificial intelligence, you don't think of it as just existing till the end of a chess game and then backing up the information from that chess game to make a better play through that chess game. You think of something that will be continually adapting and improving and changing itself, like we do. At least that's how I see it. And that's how I see a system that updates its representation, can predict its world, can control its world, and can do so with direction in a goal-seeking or purposeful way. So this is important. So real-time learning, if we're looking towards a larger goal of intelligent systems, real-time learning is very important to that goal, but it works hand-in-hand with offline or batch learning. Who dreams? Okay, cool. If you don't, that's not bad either, but I mean, there's all sorts of what you might consider batch or offline processing. Maybe you can argue whether you think that's batch processing or not, but even in biological systems, you can put electrodes on the brain of a rat, and you can actually see the rat replaying its running through a maze. Some work down actually south, I think it's down at the University of Lethbridge, that they're working on that exact thing, and they have some great videos where you can actually see the rat running through a virtual maze in its own brain. So it's not that we just use one or two or more of these different learning methods. We fuse, as humans, I would argue that we fuse many of these learning methods together. And in this case, you can see how just those two things, being able to use your imagination or use your visualization to run through experience that you've had already, and also learn from immediately from new data. Those two things play together very well and give a more powerful learning system. Okay, so we're running into the end of the talk here. I'm at about 53 minutes. So the key idea from that whole sort of cornucopia of ideas is that there are many possible, and here I'm going to say compatible and interchangeable, ways for machines to approach acquiring knowledge, maintaining that knowledge, and then using that knowledge in a purposeful way. So you as individuals who want to think about machine intelligence or who wish to actually deploy machine intelligence, keep that in the back of your mind. This is a rich field of different techniques, and that it's important not to think that there's only one particular solution which will solve these problems. There are many, many, many doors to learning and to using the things that you've learned. All right? So let's roll it back. We'll go right back to the beginning and look at our learning summary. So I'm hoping, again, this is my hope, is that by this point, you hopefully have a good idea how you might want to define machine intelligence or intelligent systems. You might guess why they're important, why we should care about them, why you should care about them, and why society should care about them, or at least think really hard about them. Because maybe they're good, maybe some people don't like them. There's things we have to think about. But importantly, whether or not you agree with machine intelligence or not, you should be able to discuss it. So I'm hoping by now you could at least sit down at a cocktail party or sit down over tea and be able to talk to someone coherently about machine intelligence. Does everyone think, does that seem like thumbs up, head nod, something? Could you? Yeah? Okay, good. I see a few motions. Few signs of life. Okay, good. Okay, so then we move down to the more specific learning objectives. We talked a little bit about what machines might want to learn. So we talked about representation, how to see the structure and the information in your perception. We talked about prediction, so building up facts. You might want to learn facts or expectations about the world, anticipations. You might want to learn what happens next. And you might want to learn how to control your world, how to act, how to behave and make decisions in that wild, scary world we've been talking about. Okay, so we move down to the how. So we talked more in depth about this. We had some fun examples. We had labeling pictures. We had clustering pictures of people that you may or may not know. And we had going to different places and taking photographs. So we had three different ways that machines might begin to learn about their world, how they might actually do it. And we didn't do any math, but I'm guessing that all of you could probably go home and after a little bit, take those pictures and figure out some kind of math that would do the things we talked about today. Because it's actually not that tricky. Under the hood, it's like one or two lines, you put it in a piece of software. There's all sorts of things you have to write to go around those two lines, but the key ideas are fairly clear. So we talked about that. One was learning from labeled examples. One was learning, finding structure in the data, actually learning about the structure of the data. And one was learning through trial and error. And then I threw in a bonus one. Remember the bonus one? Computational curiosity. It sort of fits with all of the others. It ties them all together. But it's a way of using extrinsic and intrinsic motivation to drive the behavior or the learning of a learning system. And then we talked about, very briefly, when machines might learn. Did you want to learn during ongoing experience? Or do you want to collect a big vat of data and then use it afterwards? Or maybe some mesh, some hybrid of those two. And then I threw in another learning objective here, and that's that I hope, at this point, you're getting to the point where you can actually do what I think we promised on the title of this particular talk, which is begin to sort of comprehend or imagine what might be some of the pitfalls and some of the really promising areas of using machine intelligence in modern society. And even farther, is a race towards some of the things that I know Kim talked about on Tuesday during his lecture. So these are the ideas. Again, remember, we sent out that quick little cheat sheet, the quick article I wrote, which is sort of a... It talks about most of the things here. I'll also, now that you've already seen all the pictures in my fun slides, I'll get Kim, if it's okay, to send out the PDF of this as well, so you can have that for your own reference. I'll also put it on my own website, so you can see that. And just a quick look at what's coming next time on The Promise and Perils of AI. We're going to start looking at machine intelligence as it's applied to neuroprosthetics, to brain-body-machine interfaces. So I'll take you through a whole run of different ways that humans and machines can begin to interface, begin to connect and augment humans with machines. And I'll also then tell you specifically how machine intelligence fits into that puzzle, or how the things you usually think of as machine learning, pattern analysis, and artificial intelligence can help facilitate this augmentation, or perhaps one of these doors towards rapid technological and societal change. And in particular, I think I may even come in with this little beast on. So this is one of my students, Adam Parker. He's an undergraduate student working with me, and we've been working very closely on this. It's called the X-arm. It's a third arm that mounts right to your chest. So if everything's up and running, I'm not going to promise yet, but I'll hopefully come in wearing that next time, and we'll be able to chat a little bit about that, and you can start to think about a question. I want you to keep one question in your head. We can talk about it next time. Don't think about it too much now. Let it sit for at least 2 days, percolate. But if you want to extend your body or augment yourself, augment your mind or augment your physical body or your abilities, how would you go about doing that without losing the function you already have? People usually think like, well, if I had a pair of wings, how would I flap my wings? That's an excellent question. If I stuck a prehensile tail on you, how would you move your tail? If you say, well, I'd wiggle my abdominals, well, you're using muscles you already have. You're essentially overloading the muscles you already have to do another function. Is there a clear way you can begin to extend human function or extend your own innate abilities without sacrificing innate abilities? We'll talk about this in the case of amputees and people who've lost limbs due to workplace injuries or accidents or birth defects. And we'll also talk about it in the scenario of people who haven't had any kind of injury, traumatic injury. How do you go about allowing them to intuitively control a complex system like a robot arm, like a prehensile tail, like a quadricopter flying through the air, or even like the internet? How would you control a vast digital system without overwhelming yourself and overwhelming the parts of your body you currently do control? So that's going to be the subject of next time. I hope that's okay. If not, send me an email and tell me no. I really want to go back and talk more about learning from labeled examples, and we can certainly do that too, but I think it might be kind of fun to bat these ideas around. So with that, I think we'll open it up for questions here, and thank you all very much.
So to what extent does all this depend upon the idea that there's only one right answer to things? That there's only one right answer to things? Because in ethics, in politics, in a lot of realms of human endeavor, we actually think things are determined by context and culture, and there probably isn't just one answer. So can a machine learning paradigm be created to deal with this kind of uncertainty of you come to a point of diversion in the road where you can choose A or B, with the idea that one is the right choice and one is the wrong choice, and maybe neither is absolutely right or absolutely wrong. It's kind of a shaded or nuanced choice that, you know, one choice may be a little bit better or a little bit worse. And then what about, we talk about alternative realities as a joke. Usually it's a joke when we talk about it. But is it? I mean, isn't it true that in quantum physics and string theory and so on, you know, alternative realities are really there, right? And so how does all this mesh with that?
All right, so those are all good questions. I'm going to thoroughly dodge any discussion of quantum mechanics, because not that I don't want to talk about it, but maybe that's a conversation for the pub after after the lecture. But in terms of how does machine intelligence fit into, I'm gonna paraphrase to make sure I got your questions. So the first bit is this thought that there is a right choice, and if we have multiple paths, how does machine intelligence fit into helping to figure out is there a right choice or assessing that? And the second is multiple possibilities, the idea of multiple worlds or virtual worlds, and where does it fit in there? And I think this all does boil down to a single answer. So I'm going to give it a crack for you. in terms of the right answer, so one thing that machine intelligence does allow us to do is to give many different kinds of forecasts. We talked about forecasting, anticipation, about prediction. So what do we do when we say this is the right answer, the right moral answer, or the right financial decision to make? Well, really, we're doing things like forecasting. We're doing a function approximation. We're approximating down a very wild and complex world into simpler terms that we can use to make our forecasting that leads to the decision that this is the right choice or this is not the right choice. These are the same kinds of things. And then we have to make a decision based on knowledge. So that I think that fits into the representation, the prediction, the control that we talked about during the talk here. But it's more than that, because how does, like, let's view this from the lens of if we were policymakers, or we are diligent citizens, or we are people making individual choices. How does machine intelligence fit into that picture? It fits into the picture by allowing us to vastly extend the capacity of our forecasting, so the capacity to actually make a final discrimination about yes or no, or the details of the situation, and also it vastly expands our ability to fuse together disparate and interesting forms of information. So like I said, with our very powerful and endearing meat brains, we sort of make some buckets and we sort of figure out, okay, well, how much is this worth and how much does this impact this? And we approximate things down. We simplify the world in a certain way, and we make a judgment based on that. We say good or bad or yes or no or moral or amoral. Machines can actually, some of these machine intelligence methods can start to fuse in much more information laterally, so to speak, and be able to extend those forecasts, but also to be able to say, I can actually have more buckets than you. I can actually make more discretizations, and I can do all these in parallel. So I can give you, as a machine intelligence, I'm not as a me, but as a machine intelligence, you can run many, many different scenarios. You can say, assuming that these things are important, what is the right thing to do based on these criteria? What if these are different criteria? We have the ability to do all this in parallel. So the multi-worlds thing is exactly on that point. I'm going to do a bit of a sidetrack here, because there's a whole field of learning which is called off-policy learning. So we talked about policies earlier, which is essentially the way that you take in information and use that to make decisions about what you're going to do in the world, right? Well, most of the learning that we usually see in terms of sort of the more real-time learning is it's doing something called on-policy learning. It's learning to answer questions and to make decisions based on what it's actually doing. But there's been a lot of recent work on off-policy learning, which is having control systems and learning systems which are learning about things they really aren't doing. So while I'm walking to the washroom or the water fountain or back to my office or to my lab, I'm also learning about walking to the student union building. I'm also learning about walking home to my apartment. I'm probably also learning to, like, flying to Taiwan. I'm doing many things at once. And learning systems have the capacity to do this kind of off-policy learning and off-policy projection. You can essentially say, given that we're following this course of action as a person or as a society or as a technological advancement, given we're following this pattern, what do we expect? But if that pattern were different, subtly or even fundamentally, what can we expect? Maybe the accuracy of our answers is very, very different, but we have the capacity to do that, and machine intelligence gives the capacity to do that. So that's one way it plays in. Now, and if it's machine intelligence forecasting things about machine intelligence, well, then you get your hall of mirrors. Suddenly the images start replicating rather quickly. Maybe even a rather detailed projection. Next question. Thank you.
Jason.
Question about real-time batch learning.
Yeah.
So if I'm rock climbing.
Yep.
I've done the route a few times.
Yep.
I've got my own batch file going, and I come into a problem.
Yep.
I have people watching down below, like a nice tall gangly guy and a little short girl.
Yep.
They can give me their batch files and I can modify that very, very quickly, like knowing that I'm a little bit heavier than she is, so
yep.
The hold that she might
have
to. How is machines capable of taking that kind of a batch file?
This is awesome. Thank you for the question. Do you have a follow-up question, or do you want me to dive right in?
That's it.
Okay, awesome. So you brought up issues which I didn't have time to talk about in the talk, but I really like talking about, because I actually do research in some of these areas, is that there's also the idea of multitask learning, task transfer learning, essentially what you just described. If you have, say, different individuals, and you want to sort of fuse the knowledge from different individuals to back into your own knowledge base, or if you are doing one task, and you know about this one task, you're doing a second task, you learned about that task, You come up to a third task, which you've never seen before, but which looks kind of like those other two. How do you blend those things together? How do you blend the learning? Given that these systems may represent themselves, represent the world in different ways, I'm almost certain that the body map for and the proprioception for the short girl versus the tall, lanky guy and you are going to be different. The way your mental shrink wrap, the way your body sort of puts a plastic bag around your body and says, this is what's me, that's going to be different for everybody. So blending, that's a huge challenge. If we think about it, remember let's use a simple example to sort of try and tackle it. Let's say that I'm playing racquetball. I'm simplifying your rock climbing example. Let's say I'm playing racquetball. I learned about racquetball. I'm playing tennis. I learned about playing tennis. I go to play squash. Well, that embodies some of each. Let's say that a fundamental part of my motor control, how I move my body, and how I even think about this is let's say it's predictions. Right? Let's say I'm making predictions about how my arm is going to be moving through space in any of these, the weight of the racket impacts that and things like that. And I'm taking in features of my world, like what my muscles are telling my brain, what my eyes are seeing. Okay? So in those two settings, let's just say I'm making predictions. And the predictions are the things I want to fuse. All right? It's a simplification of the control problem you just posed, but let's say we're just making predictions. Just. So in racquetball, I predict that if my arm is here and the ball is here, I'm moving at this speed, I'm going to hit the ball in 2 seconds, let's say. Let's say that I have another valuation over here with the let's say I'm playing, what did I say, racquetball and squash, and I change to tennis, whatever my example was. Racquet sport one and racquet sport two, I make two predictions. I have learned two predictions. And I have essentially a chunk of my memory, a value, evaluation or essentially a computational structure which maps the features that I'm seeing with that new task. Right. Or with the prediction I'm going to make in that task. I have that for both tasks, right? So I have two different essentially structures, those structures we talked about learning through the entire lecture. Now I go to that new task. There's two doorways that I'm going to propose to you today that can sort of deal with this fusion. One of them is that, let's do three. Doorway one is that actually based on the feature space I'm using. So if how I'm perceiving the world is abstracted in a certain way such that they're identical between these three tasks, then hopefully I could just sort of smush those predictions together based on which features are present. Like the weight of the racket may be similar to this task, but the speed I'm moving my arm may be similar to this task, right? So you could just smush them all together if your features are almost the same. Another is that somewhere in this intelligent system, there's a little bit which says, now I know I'm in this task, or now I know I'm in this task. This is less satisfying, because it doesn't let us really do that smushing as well as you'd like, but if you can uniquely identify when you're doing a task, or like I'm rock climbing, and like, okay, now I need to be the girl, and then now I need to be the guy with the long arms. If you can do that, that's another way of smushing. It's sort of a piecewise hybridization. The other way to do it, and this is something we're working on with my collaborators and one of my students, is actually looking at the structure of the data. So from the stream of experience here, or as I'm climbing up that wall, Spider-Man style, from the stream of experience, I notice I get into a bit of a bind here and I'm moving in a certain way, being able to automatically detect when you're in a new situation or new context, and then be able to weight those other learned experiences in such a way that you can combine them equally or combine them in some weighted way, some way that maybe you get 20% small woman, 50% lanky guy, and the rest is you. Finding ways to control based only on the stream of data. And you can do that by having essentially a series of learning systems that are all saying, if I were doing this kind of combination, how much error in my predictions would I expect? Or how much loss do I expect when I'm doing this? And so you say, well, my loss by combining 100% little girl and nothing else is I'm going to fall. And my loss by staying myself is, well, I'm also going to fall. And if I combine lanky guy with little girl, though, then I don't fall at all. So you can start to based on your movement, your expected losses can govern how you sort of jam these different learned things together.
So if I have a prosthetic arm,
yep,
and I take the data from John McEnroe,
yep,
I can play tennis like John McEnroe?
Well, that would be nice, wouldn't it? Wouldn't it be nice to actually have another lobe to your brain? You could just, you know, go into the library and plop one in and have it mesh perfectly and be able to sort of trickle in the bits you need from it. That'd be kind of cool too, wouldn't it?
So, well, just taking his batch file.
Yep.
Is this a feasible process?
So in terms of the prosthetic, I will make no claims about fusing things into biology itself. I'd like to think that everything I say extends into there. It should be any kind of intelligent system. But in terms of prosthetic, something we're looking at is, if you have, say, an arm shipped from the factory, You don't really want it to be tabula rasa. You'd hope that you have, you know, maybe 100 different individuals have the control patterns for those 100 individuals encoded into that limb. And when you stick it on you, it uses those as a starting point. So it actually says, yeah, you know what, I have this pro tennis player in here, and you like to play tennis? Awesome. Tell you what, I'm going to slam in 50% of pro tennis player into your limb control policy as the starting point. But it's just a starting point. You have adaptation. So now you start with 50% pro tennis player. Maybe you also want to drive a car like a pro, like Mario Andretti or something. You want to be like a pro race car driver. So now you get 25% pro race car driver, so you can drive to work in your Prius better. And then let's say you keep the other 25% for writing or for painting or something else. Like you can, the system should be able to detect what's, without you telling it, should be able to detect what kinds of things you do in it, in the stream of experience, and then be able to match that to its essentially those pre-stored files. And then put them together and give it to you as some place where you can start learning. It's not an end, but a beginning.
Perfect. Thank you.
Did that answer your question? That was long-winded. I apologize. But hopefully that was good.
So other questions?
Oh, yeah. I just wanted to say right away that I had no idea that you could program intrinsic motivation into something at all. I thought that was pretty incredible. And it seems so simple. I'm sure you simplified it a lot. But that was pretty incredible. I didn't think that was possible. But I had one question. You mentioned that currently that there's a lot of problems and that they're far too complex for us to devise a plan. I was just a little unsure about what you meant by that
Okay. Exactly. Good. Well, thank you. Yeah, thank you for bringing that up for clarification. So I'll give you one example of complexity. So I grew up in engineering, so to speak. And so my background was in finding ways to essentially engineer very robust, like robust control and robust analysis systems. Like it, essentially where we go in and we hand design a system to map inputs to outputs, sensors and data to control actions or robotic actuators. So let's take a very simple example. So if you have, if I'm measuring, let's say let's actually take the case of artificial limbs. Is that okay?
Sure.
Okay, so let's say that we have you have someone who's had an amputation. They have essentially, let's say, transhumeral. It's cut off right here. And I can measure from two muscles on their body, right? Bicep and tricep, let's say. Those muscles still exist. You can record from those, and you can use those to move a single joint. So if they flex their bicep, the joint moves up. They flex their tricep, the joint moves down. So it's pretty clear how I could go about, as a good, diligent biomedical engineer, I could go in there and say, okay, I can just, you know, subtract this one from that one, and then use some proportion of that as the input to this other joint. So, I mean, that's a pretty clear example, right?
Okay.
Let's say we even go up to another setting where you have, let's say we have the same kind of amputation, but now we want to control the elbow, maybe the hand. So maybe I could find another muscle group here or do something clever to be able to, you know, map those two signals to controlling those other joints, okay? But then the problem gets really bad. Imagine if I were to stick on, instead of a normal limb, imagine I would stick on an octopus arm. In fact, let's stick on 8 octopus arms, okay? Stick a whole octopus on there. Put it in a little spacesuit so it doesn't get dry, you know? But let's say we had a whole octopus arm right on the end of the arm there. So now you have essentially 8 limbs that all move independently and all have flexion in any different direction. It's really unclear how you could go about sending signals from the body to control that. It may almost be intractable because you're only still sampling from 2 points. But now let's say, okay, well, I can't control my octopus limb with only these 2 muscles, so how about I blanket my body with sensors that read off my muscles and my skin conductivity and my heart rate and maybe even some on my head. Okay, so now let's say I give you 10,000 sensors of all different kinds and shapes and sizes, maybe one on the tongue, maybe one of them's even like a little flag you hold on, a semaphore or something. So I give you all these signals and say, now can you write me a program that will use all of those to flexibly control and naturally and intuitively control all 8 of those octopus arms that are now attached to the end of my arm. That's obviously gross exaggeration and a bit of a cartoonish example, but I think it nicely hits on the idea that at a certain point, the number of sensors that we have and the number of kinds of sensors are going to be unfathomable. And the number of things we hope to actuate or control are going to be equally uncountable. And so at that point, and we're getting to that point already, I think, but as we step forward and as things pick up pace, the number of the richness and complexity of data will get to the point that we can't actually find a good way to map it to all the things we hope to control. And by that I mean data on the internet to other control actions on the internet, the different interconnections between the parts of an intelligent system. It gets to the point where you almost have to learn it. And there's ways you can go about doing that. Reinforcement learning or learning from examples is a great example of that. Because you can say what you want to happen. I can say, I know when my eight-pronged octopus arm has grabbed the cup. I know that. And I can say, yeah, I know that. I want to get that. I have no idea how to get my system to do it. But I know when it's achieved its objective. And so there's one way. I'm just posing one door for you. But that one door is that you can sort of trickle that approval or trickle that signal of, yeah, you did a good job, to change the system, allow the system to change itself such that it's able to make that mapping, make that connection. At least that's my research claim, and I'm holding to it. Now, give me 10 years, and I'll have the maybe an octopus arm, but we'll have some pretty complex assistive devices.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Awesome.
We're out of time, but thank you very, very much, and we look forward to part two on the 24th. So next week we have Shauna Panja on the 17th and the 19th. So her lecture on entrepreneurship in medicine is on the 17th, and the workshop is on the 19th. We'd like to have as many people in this room as we can on the 19th. They have a really active workshop, so I'm looking for all of you to recruit people to bring here on that day, which I think you'll find a lot of fun and quite memorable. Patrick, thank you very much, and we look forward to the next time.
Right. Thanks so much, everyone.